Could we have another huge round of applause for two of the pioneers of creativity who have given some of the most memorable twists to Indian cinema?
My day during making of English. My day during the making of, when she decides to make a film, my day is the simplest. I get up and watch everybody slogging, watch her slogging. I just pretend to kind of hang around, buy some coffees for people. My life is quite simple when she is making a film. My life is pretty chaotic right now when I'm making a film. Because I think anybody who makes a film, you have a fair idea of where it's going because you've written it. You know, you have a vision, you know where it's going. But you live in uncertainty every day. And you really don't know how that film is going to turn out until you edit it. Though you are subconsciously quite sure of what you're doing, consciously you're not kind of, it's a lot of luck. Which is at play every day. You know, things have to go right. A lot of people have to do their jobs well. Just a simple thing like a rain could kind of spoil someday, or somebody falling ill could spoil something, or somebody not performing well enough that day could spoil something. So you live with uncertainty every day. So you move on. So it's a job of resilience more than anything else.
So before we get into just the particular movies that you worked on, can you tell us and the audience why you came into these particular professions?
I don't know why I came into it. I've always wanted to make a film, and it's great to be speaking about cinema in a school, because when we were kids, cinema was a bad word, you know, in the sense that if you saw a movie, why did you go see a movie? Why did you study? There's a lot of things. So today cinema is considered an art by the very people, that's my parents, who told me it was bad. It's changed. Things are changing, things are evolving. There's a lot more information about cinema and what it does to people. So when I've always wanted to make films from a very early age. And I found advertising as a way, as an excuse to make films. Because you're taking somebody else's product, somebody else's money, and using their product to tell a story that you want to tell. So I found a way in advertising to do a lot of cinema. Till one day I was actually stuck for an advertising idea. It was for Lifebuoy, I remember. And we were thinking of an ad, and we were struggling. I was just sitting and staring at the guy opposite me. I suddenly had this idea for Chini Kam, and I said, yeah, that's nice. So after a long time of telling stories, after coming into the field, do films, I did a film after 15 or 17 years in advertising. I actually did my first feature.
I landed in films by accident because when I was growing up, and the films in the early 90s and 80s were not the kind of cinema I was inspired by at all. And I never saw it and thought, oh my God, this is where I want to be. I was watching a lot more international cinema, and somehow that just seemed out of reach, and it seemed like somehow world could be part of. So it never struck me that film, I just thought literature, English, writing, something, that's what I'll do. But I landed up in advertising, and in the films department of advertising. And that's when my love for film began, very late actually in life, and I really wish I could be this age or younger and know that this is what I wanted to do, and I could have studied it and gone somewhere to film school and done it, but it didn't happen. But then I learned on the job, mostly in advertising, so I owe all my knowledge of film or any experience of film to advertising. So that's 30 seconds and 60 seconds can actually teach you a lot.
So, before making English Finglish, did you have a set plan that you wanted to make your film, before even knowing what film you were going to make? Would it be completely woman-centric and have this idea? Were you looking for an idea that I want to make a movie like this, and then thought of the idea?
No, definitely not. I don't think you can decide that. And also, I've not started out, and still I'm not a social activist, as sometimes it's misconstrued. To make any social change or something was not really the objective. I think the idea is, and if it just ended up doing good for any one person also, I think it's great, because I think the main objective of cinema is to entertain. So if you, that is the first and foremost objective to fulfill. And with that, if you can say some more meaningful things or anything more exciting or that can touch the audience, that's great. But no, I just wanted an exciting story to
narrate.
This one's from Mr. Vati. A lot of your movies have strong female characters. So how do you conceptualize these characters and make them seem real and relatable to your audiences?
A lot of my films are Amitabh Bachchan. So if you want to kind of, you know, make the film interesting, you need somebody to overpower them. To give him a good run for his money. So therefore, you build up characters that are equally powerful so that the story can be interesting. You don't start writing a story by saying that I want to make a female character powerful or a male character powerful. You just write a story in your heart. And characters will always come out the way you are as a person or the way you think of things as a person. Because you can't write a story that you're not, somewhere in your head. You know, you can't write about people. I may not know a lot about people, but this is how I'd like people to be. Cinema to me is about how I'd like the world to be, not how the world is, actually. Cinema is always about making the world slightly better than what it is. You know, in the hope, that's why we watch.
So about not only English Finlish, but some of your other movies, did you ever anticipate the reviews and the acclaim that it got?
No. No, not at all. Wasn't thinking of the end. In fact, didn't even know. I thought I was looking for places to hide it after it released, so in case I need to use that.
On the same note, how do the two of you take unfavorable reviews?
Just as you take favorable reviews. And ignore them. Yeah.
I don't take them well, or dare they even say. So I don't think anybody likes to be criticized. And this whole thing of learning from criticism and all this stuff is a myth. Nobody likes to be criticized. Well, everybody likes to be praised. And I think the job of a critic is to praise the film. It's just to kind of criticize it. We don't criticize their reviews, not dare they criticize our film.
So now we have some inputs from the literature and performance section. So, both of you all have directed child actors in all of the three films that you all have made. What are the challenges when you are directing child actors specifically?
She should answer.
It is great fun to work with if the child happens to be a good actor. And is not cranky. So I actually like to meet them way in advance before I'm actually shooting with them. So I shortlist a few kids and I meet all of them and I get a sense of what kind of behavior they see. Sometimes may be a good actor but may really be a badly behaved child and you don't want to deal with that because that's not actually not because of that, you just don't like any badly behaved people. So I'm treating children the same way. So and they're way smarter. They actually can talk to you as adults, so I'm telling him, if I'm not badly here, why are you so, you know, so that's the only way you do. It's if you just treat them and respect them, you know, as just as people, and not look down on them and say, oh, you know, they don't, I mean, somehow it doesn't work with them, and they look at you like you're some dog, so I think just to treat them as equals, and they're smart enough to get it, so I've been lucky to work with some really good kids who are part of the talent. Really lovely people.
What is the difference between makeup, costume, lighting, etc. between ad films and feature films, since you made both of them?
One big difference is time. You get very little time feature film. But most importantly, always remember that a feature film, the screen is much bigger. So the detailing, even if you have little flaws, it shows when you blow up an image. Okay, so a makeup, for example, on a smaller screen, you may just get away with it, or you can touch it up digitally, because it's, first of all, let's say it's a shorter duration, you can actually touch up every shot. In a feature film, 2.5 hour film, if you try touching up every shot, it's going to take you 3 years to do it. So you've got to get things, the detailing has to be, in terms of lighting and hiding flaws, it's going to be a lot more perfect in feature film, because it will show.
How do you get an actor to break the kind of stereotypes that an audience has about them and play the character? For example, so you've worked with Mr. Bachchan a lot, so have you, ma'am, he did a cameo in English. So how do you kind of get the audience to forget that, okay, this is Mr. Bachchan on screen, but it's the character?
Actually, I don't want them to forget. He's Mr. Bachchan, because I think there are some people who are characters themselves. Amitabh Bachchan is a bigger character than any character you can create for him. So therefore, why would I want to lose that? Why would I want to make him Nasiruddin Shah? I wouldn't. Because it takes a lot to be Amitabh Bachchan. So therefore, even in order, even in power, it is Amitabh Bachchan as a 15-year-old kid, not any other 15-year-old kid. So if he was a cranky 15-year-old kid, that's what he would be. So an audience also very, very sharp. You know, when they're seeing characters, they come to watch a Shah Rukh Khan film, an Amitabh Bachchan film, a Rajinikanth film. They have very clear ideas about the star they want to watch. You can do that much with a star. You know, if you do something else with the star, they don't like it, because you don't like to tamper with something that you like, beyond the point. So it's very important that you understand the stars are characters themselves and don't tamper with them beyond the point.
What kind of audiences were you all aiming for, and how difficult is it to reach out to all kinds of audiences? Because, say, English Vinglish, the main audience here is very patriarchal, and the theme was about kind of like women empowerment. So how difficult is it to, you know, have a broad audience watching the film?
Audience is really not in your hand. I think you just do your best and put whatever you think is best out there, and then see who likes it. I mean, you imagine that if you have really liked what you're doing, and a few other people who you believe in have given you the same feedback, you just hope that another 100 people and multiply, you know, it happens on its own. But you can't really decide how many people are going to see your film.
I agree totally, because I think there is only one audience, that's you. And if you happen to be the kind of person who shares the same view as another million people, then you're a good filmmaker. If your view happens to be contradictory, or if what you like, nobody likes, then you're a bad filmmaker. So there's no good filmmaker and bad filmmaker, it's just that how you must be lucky that you make something that you like and 100 million like. Otherwise, you're not a good filmmaker. It's as simple as that. There's no other difference between a good filmmaker. It's a lot of luck.
And what aspects do you consider when you're casting for a particular character? Because I'm sure there's like a thought
stuff. Looking for someone who can play that particular role, whatever that role is, the role in question is, who can complete justice. So for me, I'm not thinking of the star or the actor and then writing to that person. I'm writing a role and then hoping and crossing my fingers and toes that somebody I meet that fall in place and actually be able to play this character. So the person has to, and with a little X factor, something that you can't define, but this something called charm and something that you can't really say that why you like Ranbir Kapoor. There are very obvious reasons, and there is something that you can't say why came this. Someone more good looking actually. But why is Ranbir? So you look for something that is beyond fitting the character.
Since all of us are in school now, some of us are heading off to university soon, what can you tell us about something that you learned in university that either was applicable or that you had to unlearn while in the profession?
Some instances and anecdotes. So much to unlearn, yes.
Well, it's chose the wrong field. That's the only regret I have in my life is I chose commerce. And it's my only regret. I mean, I've done worse things since then. But that still remains my biggest regret. Should have, arts is what I wanted to do. But all for the wrong reasons. And like in my 12th chapter, in fact, is when I had a chance to move to arts, when I had already wasted 2 years, 11th and 12th. And I don't know what I was doing in bookkeeping and accounts, and it was not my thing. But I had made a group of friends, and I didn't want to part, and they were like, and they were going to continue in commerce. And those, which then seemed like strange reasons, that seemed very valid and important. And I did, but it remains my regret that I could have done a field of, a course that I wanted to. So after my graduation, actually I went and did MA in arts, just because I just missed having done that. So yeah, I can't really unlearn, I quickly unlearned all the accounts. I cannot remember, I'm terrible at it, so I didn't really need to spend time unlearning it. I just still don't get numbers. So yeah.
I think the only thing that I can tell you guys is when you go into universities, choose what you want to study. Because there's a really important time in your life where, I mean, you're lucky that today you have so many things to choose from. You can study exactly what you want to study, unlike us. Like me, I don't know, I knew I wanted to be, but there weren't many film schools. There was no chance of going abroad to study at that point of time, and I didn't know what to do. In fact, I went into a film school. I actually went and did my interview at the, I was in Bangalore, so the closest was Chennai Film Institute. And there were very bad people who were interviewing me, so I ran away from that place. So I didn't know what else to do. I went and joined the computer applications, MCA opposite, because it was just right opposite the film school. And I could play cricket because it was a university that was known for producing cricketers, so I was going on playing cricket there. And for 3 years I was just whiling away my time playing cricket, and they said that you don't have attendance, you can't write the exam. So 3 years I didn't know what to do, so I ran away again. So there were years that I could have studied so much, that I could have done a lot more if I just had an opportunity, or somebody had taken me to a place and said, this is where you can study this. Today you guys have that. Please choose what you want to study, because it's fancy hearing of people who've done something, and you can change course later on in life. But at least for some period of time, you need to kind of do what you really want to do.
What has the evolution of a stylist been in films, and how important are they to, styling your characters?
Really, really important. Because I think a stylist adds a lot. If you take, take Vidya Balan in Pa, she was going through what I call a style crisis at that point of time. And actually Gauri and Sabyasachi both styled her together and said that she should be looking like that. It was a great thing for her because she was in character, it was playing to her strengths, and somebody had to get the style right for her. Each style is very different for each person. So a stylist played a very, very huge role in Vidya's character.
So, do the two of you ever think of, working together more, or do you prefer keeping the professional personal life separate?
Definitely. Keeping it separate.
Yeah.
Unless it's Diwali, it doesn't make sense. Too many fireworks.
Do people often compare your work, and how do you feel about that?
Never. I don't think, when you do films, we've done 3 films together now, and there's not much to compare and things like that. And I don't think we compare. You can't compare your own work with yourself. How will you compare it with anybody else, even if it happens to be your wife or husband? Because it's impossible to compare films. I can't say one film is better than the other film. They're two different films altogether.
Ms. Gauri, for Ms. Sridevi, she was once, she had all these glamorous roles like in Chandni and Chalwar, etc. And this was her comeback film. why did you decide to give her this particular challenging role?
I didn't decide to give her the role. The role existed, that's what I'd written already. And then I happened to find her. And she got interested in the role. And I was very glad that, and I thought that, yeah, this woman could fit this role. So that's how it happens, I think. Unless you're writing for a star, and you're thinking of story, okay, now I want to write for Sri Devi, let me see what I can write for her, or you know, create for her that she can do and then challenge. So it's a different
way. This is for Mr. Blackie. Jeannie Kam was set in London. What do you think the setting added to the plot and the value of that film?
Whatever I shot in my first film would have been set in London. Because it is my favorite city. I love the city. Like her favorite city is New York, my favorite city is London. So whatever I shot would be there. But I think it's important. Somewhere I just believe that that story of a chef and the kind of humor that the film had just works better there. The story worked better there. But even if it hadn't, that was possible. So it's okay.
What did the language itself mean? I mean, I understand that it was this barrier, but when she learned English, wasn't she still conforming to her family and society and what they wanted?
I think the biggest thing, I think, for a parent is for the child to respect them. And when that stops happening is when you question and you know, want to do something about that. The biggest low point for a parent, I would imagine, is that. And children after a certain age, they don't stop loving, but you start judging your parents, which was like unconditional love before a certain age that you. So you want to relook at your life, which is what Shashi, the character, does. And she's not conforming as much as wanting to create some sort of confidence in herself, wherein her kids, her husband, whatever, the people that she cares about can look up to her with respect. And then show it to them, yeah, I did this. And of course, at the end of it, she says, yeah, so I did this, big deal. I'm just be the person who I am. But you needed that strength and that confidence to get there, to be able to say, what's the big deal about this English or the language?
So, what did you want to convey through the romantic track in the movie between Shashi and her French classmate?
That things, shit happens, all things happen. that's part of life, and it happens when you least expect it. And it's not part of a bigger plan that you have.
To what extent did you consciously create the children as flat characters who are not multi-dimensional to aid to the plot in Jeannie Kam and English English? To what extent did you consciously create the children as flat characters who are not multi-dimensional to aid to the plot in Jeannie Kam and English English?
Children as flat characters to aid to the plot in Jeannie Kam and English English. I don't think they were flat characters, they were children. And children are not flat. Children are the most interesting people. And Jeannie Kam, it was like she had 9 years to live and she was an adult. She didn't have the time to be an adult. She was trying her best to be an adult before she died. So, and she was thinking like an adult, trying her best as a child to speak like an adult, which a child can never, but you're trying. So it's not so much a flat character. As much as part of the story, and that's how the character needed to be. Any child you take, it can never be a flat character.
Thank you. Okay, so I think we're going to move into discussion now.
You want the mic?
Yes.
Please raise your hands if you have a question to ask. Don't worry, interesting questions, funny questions, more questions, whatsoever. Just be polite.
No, you can not be polite.
Yeah. I had a question specifically to do with English English. How did you pull the casting coup that was Sri Devi? And what did it do to transform the film's fate? Did it change anything in terms of producers, the kind of budget that they were offering you, your vision and scale for the film? Shooting in New York is expensive by any measure, even if it's an indie film. So how did it change that? Did it aid, or was that something that was already in place before Sri Devi came into the picture?
The story I had decided once it was done and reviewed and with whatever feedback and everything, and I knew that this is the story I want to tell. I didn't want to change it, not for any producer, not for anyone. Sri Devi happened to me like, you know, like love happens, and you know, yeah, so it was like that. It was a blind date I went on to see, you know, if I haven't watched that many films actually, and she knows that of her. And I didn't know how she was going to be because 15 years she was out of the scene, so I go meet her.
So was she, I'm sorry, was she looking for projects, or was that something new?
I don't think she was consciously or overtly looking for things, but maybe, I don't know, so it's fate. It's very strange that it just so happened that Balki was in fact with her husband around her and said, no, you know, my wife's actually making a film, and they asked him, what is this film about? So he gave them a one-liner, and she said, oh, that sounds really interesting, can I hear? That's when there was a plot saying, oh my god, there's Sri Devi also on the radar, you know, I'd not even thought of her. So I went to meet her, narrated the script, and she loved it. And I was watching her first time live, like seeing her physically there, and just something just seemed right, like I said, that's why I'm equating it to love, because you can't really explain it, you just feel this person is right for this. And that's what happened. Of course, it meant a lot having her in the film, because I think no one could have created her the way she has. But the rest of it was always the way it was meant to be. It was New York. It was, and I don't think it changed the minds of producers that much, because I don't think anyone wanted to invest in a film that was being made by, I don't think female director is such a big deal, but a new director who had no experience except advertising. And then it's a film about a middle-aged woman with kids wearing a sari, not a glamorous role with many skirts. And, no jumping and dancing and no violence. So yeah, it was a no go.
Did you have in mind before, if you don't mind sharing?
Not really. I was trying to think of various women who are around us. I mean, now, yes, the other thing, we have a dearth of actors. Actually, we just need many more people. Much more talent is required to be around as choice. So I was considering, you just go through those days and you're not fully like, no, this is not my Shashi. It only happened when she felt right.
Also, I think, you know, both of us believe in one thing. I think the most important part of film making is actually the writing. You need to invest behind the script. I mean, what does the script require? You cannot enhance the value of the script by an actor or anything else. The script has to have a certain value. And if that is not... if you don't decide to make a film on the basis of that, then you shouldn't be making that film, regardless of who it is.
I have a question. In Bollywood or the general Indian film industry, regardless of Hollywood or Tollywood or anything, what do you think the attitude towards, like, you know, small-time actors who are coming up is? Because, like, I've heard stories of many, you know, different actors who have tremendous talent, but still aren't able to get that foothold in the industry, and they end up just playing these small roles in big films, and by chance they're lucky, some of them just, like, you know, become stars. So,
like Gauri was saying, I think there is a tremendous shortage of actors that we have, and everybody is in constant search of good actors and good people. But what happens is, you know, it's very, it's a coincidence. There are so many things that you need. There are so many people who want you to have it, but you don't need it. Okay? And they are searching in the wrong places, and you're searching in the wrong places. And magic happens when somebody or providence brings you both together and you work together. So always great actors find the right script. It's not every great actor finds the right script, or every great script finds the right actor. When that happens, when chance brings the two together, it's fantastic. So I think we need more mechanisms to get greater actors towards directors and filmmakers than there exists, because we have some casting people, we have casting directors who actors go to, and the casting directors are in touch with a lot of production companies. So either you see them in an ad sometimes, or you see them in a play sometimes, you see them in something else somewhere. You have to see that. How do you know that an actor exists? 1 billion people in this country. How do you know? And how does the actor know that you exist? So it's evolving slowly, slowly. There are more people searching, there are more people bringing people towards you. So it's happening, but it'll take time.
On the previous question of audiences, you had said that the only audience is you, and if your view is shared by the millions of others who will watch your movie, then you're a good filmmaker, and quite the opposite for a bad filmmaker. But when you look at art films, the director's view might not be shared by millions of others, but there might be lots of other artistic elements. Could he still be characterized as a bad filmmaker if his view is not shared by millions of other people?
I'll tell you something. You guys must see this film called recently, because it's a recent film, I'm not just talking about that. Film called Aankho Dekhi. Have you seen it? Have you heard about it? I don't think a lot of people would have heard about it. It came for a week or something and vanished. People thought it was an art film. People thought it was a boring film. It's one of the most entertaining and beautiful films that I've seen. But the unfortunate part of it is there it's not the case of a lot of people not liking it. A lot of people didn't have an opportunity to see it. Film's responsibility or it's the, I don't know, that's the producer's responsibility or people are promoting the film to make sure that people know it's an interesting film to watch. After you watch it, after enough number of people watch it, they don't like it, that's too bad. Okay. You can call yourself a good filmmaker. Well, I don't like it, so you're a bad filmmaker. So it's the number of people are going to call you bad, the number of people are calling you good. That's what it is. It doesn't make you a good or bad filmmaker. I was talking of the definition today of a good filmmaker is not how good you are, how bad you are, but how many more people like what you've done. So that's simple in life. That doesn't mean you're bad. So you have to have a laugh at it. Oh shit, yeah, not so many people don't like it. Too bad. That's the only way you can live life, otherwise you can't.
Thank you, sir.
Ruby.
So even though I guess we've progressed a lot in our outlook towards the arts in general, a fear definitely exists amongst our generation, even today, of taking up a career in the arts, in the sense of becoming a struggling artist and of not having an income is, I guess, the biggest fear if you take up a job in the arts, even in the film industry. So in all honesty, how irrational would you say that fear is today?
I think it's a problem that the artists have to correct for you to first make that change. Because I think today artists, you know, there are stars and there are artists. Like, let me put it broadly. There's something about artists that like, they like to project themselves as, you know, struggling, poor, not interested in wealth, not interested in, you know, like a businessman would kind of say, hey, I'm worth a billion, I'm worth this much, I'm this, I've got this building, that building. You will see stars kind of having that lifestyle. You'll never see artists kind of flaunting their wealth. But there are very many wealthy, as many struggling artists that there are very, very wealthy artists too in every field, not just in cinema. There are huge many artists. I think it's time to kind of, you know, PR the wealth of artists for you to change their opinion. Because struggle is normally as you know, you've got this guy who's dirty, who's bleeding, who's coughing, who's there with his painting up there, looking all over the place, nobody there, often, dying all alone. This is the image we like to have of an artist. Completely the opposite. Okay, almost, there are 50% of the artists struggle, like in any profession, 50% of engineers struggle, 50% of doctors struggle, 50% of everybody struggles. The same thing with artists. So please take up a career in art, you'll be the other 50%. Don't worry.
So we often say that cinema holds a mirror to society, right? And we have a movie like Chini Kam, which is a very mature romance. And sometimes you can get away with jokes like Chacha Ko Durex, and I remember that. That's one of my favorite jokes from the movie. But then,
why did you see Chini Kam?
Moving on. Censorship obstructs the message that you are trying to give, or perhaps when you deal with a taboo subject, seemingly taboo subject, do you think this the censor board is actually, well, going against what you want to convey to the audience?
Acha to duration time.
Well, okay, when I'm talking about a topic that perhaps would not be widely accepted yet, it's something that you wish to make a movie about. So, do you think as in the filmmaking industry as a whole, censorship is something that obstructs creative license, or when you want to convey a message that you can't because it's simply not acceptable?
See, any form of censorship on any field is bad. I think human beings have to kind of have the control and the discipline to figure out what is right and how to be responsible. But on the other hand, there are a lot of irresponsible people too. So you need bodies to get the control. It's like a police. I mean, an ideal society should need cops, right? People should all behave themselves and be very disciplined. The world will be full of good people. But you need cops because they're bad. So you need censorship. And sometimes what they do, the censors have a far more holier-than-thou attitude than what is necessary. And I think, again, it's a progressive society. As society changes, the censor board also will develop a sense of humor. As they are, in a lot of cases, they have actually matured a lot more than what they were before. It is evolving. Even in the US, for example, sometimes what we get away with in India is not passed in the US in a lot of cases. You only hear of examples of what is available in the US and what we can't watch. A lot of other cases too. Like I did an ad, for example, on Bajaj, which says "Feel Like God," okay, on a bike called Avenger. There were guys in the U.S. And my advertising colleagues said, "How did you get away with that ad? So what's wrong with that ad?" It's apparently a lot of religious people would have hammered you if you'd done that in the U.S. Because you think you're God, and you're talking off like "I forgive" and do that stuff. God, as we use here, has got a very different meaning there, you know. So it's even the way you communicate what is offensive to some people, what's not offensive to you, are different. So each society has its own norms and thing, and it's something that sets about some way to respect the sensitivity of society.
Thank you.
So I think the films you made are slightly different from the mainstream commercial films. So have you ever thought about making like a Chennai Express or a Dabang or something like that? And what are your, do you value critic reviews and ratings?
Somebody's already making Chennai Express, Dabang, why make it again?
I mean, like commercial films like that.
Every film is a commercial film. I'm not, nobody's a philanthropist out there.
No, the films that are made for the masses, I mean, your audience is like...
You don't think you're the mass? Everybody does. All the masses, you know, it's a special person. What you're basically saying is, can I have a film with Shah Rukh Khan, with five songs, which can be have 4,000 prints, can be in every theater in the country? When I get a story, when I want to make something like that, you make it. Right now, you don't want to make it, and somebody else already made it. And even life, if you've chosen cinema and you can't be different in that, where else can you be different?
Part of the question is that there's an assumption that if you get the right actors, if you get that formulaic movie, you can make about 200 crores, 300 crores easily, then why do people struggle? Is that a valid question?
I'll tell you why also. There are only four people. Shah Rukh Khan, Salman Khan, Amir Khan, and Hrithik Roshan, and Ranbir Kapoor, and one more Ranbir Singh. Four or five people are there. How many films do these six guys do? Can't do. Amir also, I've been pulled down. So, maximum, then there'll be only seven films released in a year. Will you guys wait? For seven films, you can't. Now somebody else will make other films also.
Okay, we can take a couple of questions since I'm Ms. Raju.
Good afternoon. I would like to ask this question to both of you, and that is, has your creative process changed over the years with the films that you've been making? The way you conceived an idea, the way you implemented it, has it evolved, has it changed, or is it something that you can't really control or modify?
I have only made one question to him, but I'm sure
Okay, the students who need to go for the photographs, so the student council members and the Damon students only. Yeah, so you can just leave quietly. Only the student council members and the Damon students.
Whoever else wants to go.
No. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So, yeah, I would imagine that it would change. I mean, like the most cliched statement, that only constant is change. And you could, I mean, if I'm the same person as I was last year, then I better do something about it. Same goes for the world.
I wanted to ask from the point of view of establishing the set, how do you break the views people have about popular cities like Manhattan? People have a very distinct image of Manhattan. How would you change that to show Manhattan from the point of view of a character like, say, Shashi?
Actually, it is, it's my view. It's how I have looked at Manhattan and what I would imagine Shashi to. You know, so it's first and foremost is how I see it and my vision of that city or that setting on a backdrop for my film. So it is my vision. I don't care about how everybody else is looking at me. It's my view. Only then will it be my voice and my story and not how Manhattan is supposed to be. So I think it needs to be obvious.
Okay, one last question. I think we got a young actress and mistress. Yeah, she gets it.
Do we have actresses and actors here?
Yeah. You said writing is the most important part about the film. So in advertisements where you have such a short time to convey a message, how much more challenging is the task for the writing process?
Yeah, the very existence of advertising agencies will tell you that writing is hugely important in advertising, because to get an idea for a product, tell a story in 30 seconds and make it engaging is a challenge. So I think it's as important in advertising as in cinema.
I think we need more, as we need actors and actresses, we need writers, we need content creators, I mean, like ideas. And that's where it rests on. While watching a movie, I mean, what is it you all have liked? I'm really interested in knowing what you all watch. I mean, what are the movies that, like any of you, what are the popular movies, I mean, movies that you all have really liked? Anyone? What are you all a big fan of?
Queen.
Yeah, anything else?
Last movie I saw was Finding Fanny. That was, I think, really interesting and different.
So stuff like this that you watch, I mean...
What do you like?
I like
Europa.
Europa. Europa. I want to see that. I've seen it.
Okay, on that note, I think we come to the end of the program. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dan. The formal vote of thanks. Let's do that.
Environment and surroundings while acting.